Hello everyone, I am the Medhead Kirby, and welcome to my channel, The Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic the Gathering format. The Brewery is a series on this channel showcasing my spicy brews and other deck techs. On this episode of The Brewery, I'll be discussing my take on the partner pairing of a new commander and a reprinted commander from Commander Legends, Tormod the Desecrator, and Sidar Kondo of Jammerot. If you like this deck or any of the cards I'll be mentioning throughout the video, please consider using my TCG Player affiliate link when purchasing those cards. You can find that link down in the description. It'll really help out the channel. A more significant way you can help support the channel is with my Patreon. For just $1 a month, patrons get early access to scheduled videos on YouTube, while higher tier patrons get access to the VIP section of my Discord server as well. You can find a link to both down in the description. Alright, let's get back to the episode. Tormod is a 4-2 zombie wizard for 3 generic and 1 black. Whenever one or more cards leave your graveyard, he creates a tapped 2-2 zombie creature token. Since this isn't limited to reanimation or to creatures, this ability is pretty strong. For example, even replaying a fetch land from your graveyard triggers Tormod. Cards with dredge, cards with a built-in reanimation effect, etc. are especially useful since they will provide a token creation engine with Tormod that will help power combos. However, Sidar Kondo is partnered with Tormod not just to give him access to green and white, but because Sidar Kondo essentially makes our zombie tokens unblockable. While the main way the deck wins is via combo, it's still possible to also amass a large enough army to swarm the board. He isn't a pushover either. He's a 2/5 human knight with flanking for 2 generic, 1 green and 1 white, so he's also potentially unblockable himself. In more grindier games, getting some damage each other turn can definitely add up. Let's start with how Tormod is a key engine piece in the command zone. The deck is running Gravecrawler, Bloodsoaked Champion, Reassembling Skeleton, and Nether Trader, which are all creatures that can reanimate themselves, so to speak. While all of these can form part of an infinite combo, only Gravecrawler and Nether Trader can also generate infinite mana. Even if you're not able to go infinite with these creatures, they're still amazing at creating zombie tokens with Tormod all on their own with any of the sacrifice outlets in the deck. The most important of which are Ashnod's Altar and Phyrexian Altar. We do need colored mana in order for the previously mentioned creatures to be reanimated, so Phyrexian Altar is needed for going infinite. But Ashnod's Altar is still amazing not just as a sacrifice outlet, but also as a way to get ahead in mana by sacrificing a bunch of creatures. Now, sacrificing creatures to generate mana that will pay for reanimating them isn't necessarily enough to win on its own. We need the purpose to these combos, and that's where Corpse Knight, Sir Conrad the Grim, Zulaport Cutthroat, Bastion of Remembrance, Plague Vulture, and Wayward Servant come in. Unfortunately, the last two of these only work if the creature in question are zombies, but Tormod creates zombies, so they're at least viable with Tormod as an engine piece. However, the first four are even better, since they trigger off of any creature. These cards essentially turn the infinitely looping engine into a win con, since all opponents lose life with each iteration. Let's take the simplest and most common case as an example to show off the engine. Let's say we have Tormod, Gravecrawler, and Phyrexian Arena on the battlefield. Sacrificing Gravecrawler will generate 1 black mana. That mana will then be used to recast it from the graveyard since we control a zombie, which is Tormod. This triggers Tormod, creating a 2-2 zombie. We're now back to the beginning, but with an extra zombie. If we keep doing this, we'll generate infinite tapped zombies. These zombies can then be sacrificed to the altar to generate infinite mana. Let's see how we get infinite mana with Nether Trader as well. This one requires some tricky timing to pull off, as well as already having a zombie token in play, or some other creature we can sacrifice to the altar to start the loop. Sacrifice Nether Trader for mana. It can only return from the graveyard if a creature gets put there, so we sacrifice the zombie to generate one more black mana. This triggers Nether Trader. We use one of those 2 black mana to return it to the battlefield. This triggers Tormod, creating a replacement zombie token. This puts us back where we started, but notice that with an extra black mana. Doing this infinitely many times generates infinite black mana. This would be the same process for Bloodsoaked Champion and Reassembling Skeleton, since they require 2 mana to return to the battlefield. So either of those two won't generate infinite mana, but they will still produce infinite death triggers and infinite enter the battlefield triggers. Thus, if we had, for example, Sir Conrad on the battlefield while we went through these loops, we'd win. Keep in mind that this will also work with either of the other 5 similar effects mentioned earlier, along with Sir Conrad. Even though Tormod, which is a key piece of some of these combos, is always available in the command zone, the deck is also running Desecrated Tomb as a backup plan. Even though it doesn't create zombie tokens, we can still sacrifice the bat tokens to the altar to generate mana. If we're going aggro, we're also still creating infinitely many 1-1 flyers. Same with the zombies. If we don't have any of our win cons on the board, if we're able to swing in with infinite tokens, it's still game over. However, without those win cons, but with infinite mana, Exsanguinate and Debt to the Deathless can also win us the game. Even without infinite mana, these spells are still amazing at putting us way ahead compared to the rest of the table. Or, we might just have enough mana to win right then and there. Another potential engine without self-reanimating creatures is thanks to the Gitrog Monster and Dakmor Salvage. Not only is the Gidrog monster great in the deck in its own right, since the deck is running a ton of fetch lands plus effects that let us play lands from our graveyard, but with Dagmar Salvage, it has the potential of going infinite. Let's quickly see how that works. Ideally, this is done during our cleanup step if we have to discard down to maximum hand size. Assuming we have the Gidrog monster, Tormod, and something like Wayward Servant on the battlefield, and Dagmar Salvage in our hand. If we have to discard down, we discard Dagmar Salvage. That triggers the Gidrog monster. However, instead of drawing a card, we dredge Dagmar Salvage, self-milling 2, and getting it back into our hand. Since it left the graveyard, it triggers Tormod, creating a zombie token, which in turn triggers Wayward Servant. Once all triggers resolve, we have to once again discard down to maximum hand size, and we do this all over again. As long as we have enough cards in our library to not deck ourselves before our opponents die, we win. Again, as with the previously explained combos, this one also has plenty of different configurations that will still achieve the same goal. If instead of Wayward Servant you had something like Zulaport Cutthroat on the battlefield, you'd also need a free sacrifice outlet in order to trigger the Cutthroat in order to ping opponents. So all of these cards in the deck that work well on their own can also be assembled in various different configurations in order to achieve infinite combos. Another card that works amazingly well on its own is Tortured Existence. Not only does this cost 1 black to cast, but it also costs 1 black to activate. When we discard our creature card to return a creature card to our hand, this triggers Tormod, creating a zombie token. So even though we can use this to recover better creatures than we're discarding, it's a piece to another engine. Let's see what I mean. With Tormod, Tortured Existence, and Phyrexian Altar on the battlefield, we need any creature in our graveyard and any creature card in our hand. We pay for the enchantment once, which triggers Tormod, creating a zombie. We can now sacrifice this zombie to the altar to generate the mana needed to pay for the enchantment. This will also create infinite triggers. So if we had something like Bastion of Remembrance or any other cards with a similar effect, the table will lose all their life and we win. Again, even if we can go infinite, this can still go a long ways. In case we are able to create a significant amount of zombies but aren't able to reach infinity yet, there are plenty of ways to make the most of those zombies in case you have to go with the aggro backup plan. Amulet of Vigor helps in getting those zombie tokens entering untapped ready to block. It might not seem like much, but the deck only has 25 creatures, so it goes a long way to help against other horde decks. Doubling Season, Parallel Lives, and Anointed Procession also help in making the most of our zombie tokens by duplicating the amount Tormod creates. Keep in mind that while these can be amazing to generate a very terrifying board state that could potentially out-army the other opponents, this also means that it's much easier to generate infinite mana with the previous combos that don't do so. Generating twice as many zombie tokens means more to sacrifice to the altars, so these enchantments work well with either strategy. Lord of the Undead, Risen Executioner, and Undead Warchief further help our strategy by making those zombies more than just 2/2s. This reduces the amount of zombies you actually need to overpower the table, but it also means that your zombies are much more dangerous both in an aggressive strategy or if you need to keep up blockers. Granted, making their power higher than 2 nombos with Sidor Kondo, but the deck's also running Zombie Master and Urborg Tomb of Yawgmoth. Not only does the Master give Regenerate to all of our zombies, which is also a great way to protect Tormod, but giving them Swamp Walk with Urborg on the battlefield makes our zombie horde unblockable. Urborg is also great on its own since the deck's running Cabal Coffers. This goes a long way with the previously mentioned Exsanguine and Death to the Deathless. But since we're also potentially replaying our fetches from the graveyard each turn, it also allows them to tap for mana when we have nothing left to fetch for. We can also use our zombies for responses thanks to Noxious Ghoul. Thankfully, most of our combo pieces are zombies anyways. So even if we can't loop indefinitely, looping enough times can actually help us wipe the board of all non-zombie creatures, whether they have Indestructible, Shroud, Hexproof, Regenerate, Can't Be Sacrificed, etc. So this can also help us swing in with the zombie horde practically unopposed. Either way, the deck is running my favorite mono-black enchantments, Grave Pact and Dictate of Erebos. Each time we sacrifice a creature, our opponents have to do the same. If we loop that engine enough times, we'll potentially wipe their boards of creatures. While synergistic and the most effective way to go about it, we also need some straightforward interaction. The deck's running Beast Within, Generous Gift, and Assassin's Trophy. Nothing special here, these instants are amazing catch-alls that can literally get rid of any permanent without protection, so use appropriate threat assessment when casting these. Casualties of War is also included to get rid of plenty of permanents at a reasonable cost. For just 6 mana, you can get rid of up to 5 different permanents. They have to be of different types, but in a multiplayer game of Commander, you're bound to find all 5 targets. Possibly most important of all is Silence. If we want our combo to go off without a hitch, all we really need is to cast this and have it resolve before we start the game-ending combo. It won't prevent abilities from being activated, but at least no surprise counterspells or responses to prevent us from winning. Other defensive spells include Akroma's Will, Flawless Maneuver, Heroic Intervention, and Teferi's Protection. The latter two can actually protect our entire board state, but the first two protecting our creatures is also enough since most of our combo pieces are creature-based after all. Akroma's Will also doubles as a finisher, since we can use it on a large enough zombie horde to swing into opponents and either take them out or gain a ton of life in the process while leaving them with low life. We can also recover things we couldn't protect with Bow of Nylea. This is such an amazing card in and of itself. It's definitely a Swiss Army knife. Not only will it give our attacking zombies death touch, making it very difficult to want to trade in combat, but it can also be used to put up to 4 cards from our graveyard on the bottom of the library. Not only will this help us recover things, which we can also shuffle our library with fetch lands so we can move them around, but that will trigger Tormod too. So while the other modes are definitely useful, this one's the best one for this deck. Whisper Blood Liturgist can help us reanimate a creature at instant speed. We do have to sacrifice 2 creatures to do so, but we'll have fodder for that. This will also trigger Tormod, getting us an extra creature anyways. While not used necessarily as part of an engine, it's still a very useful effect if we need some key creature from the graveyard while also triggering either Tormod or Desecrated Tomb. Eerie Ultimatum and Victimize also do something similar, with the Ultimatum being the better of the two. Even though board wipes don't set us back that much, since the deck does have a certain flair for reanimation, being able to return all of our creatures to the battlefield for just 7 mana while everyone else has to rebuild is quite satisfying. As I mentioned earlier, Crucible of Worlds and Ramanop Excavator are included to replay our lands from the graveyard. Not only do these work amazingly on their own to replay fetches and never miss a land drop, while also thinning our deck of lands, but they will trigger Tormod, which is the most important thing. We get a land and a 2/2 for it. Both are included not just for redundancy, but because creatures tend to be weaker than artifacts in terms of the amount of removal for them. We can also use the game's many engines for card advantage. If we equip Skull Clamp to a creature before they get sacrificed, we're able to draw 2 cards for just 1 generic mana. This can go a long way if we need to dig through our deck. This is why Ashen's Altar is such a great sacrifice outlet here. It gives us 2 colorless to pay for the equip cost twice, as well as providing the outlet to draw the cards. Undead Augur is another synergistic way to draw a ton of cards, especially when most of the tokens we're creating are zombies. Be careful though, since it's not a you may trigger. At least you can sacrifice it before you die if you can. Either way, if one of the combo pieces in play is also gaining you life, then you don't have to worry about the life loss. Viscera Seer and Rasikas the Foul-Blooded are some more free sacrifice outlets. The Seer is amazing since it's so cheap to cast and the sacrifice is free. You might not draw a card outright, but you can filter your draws. Rasikas is a bit difficult to cast at 8 mana, with 3 of those being black, but you can also just discard him and then reanimate him, which is very possible to do early on. Rasikas is obviously one of the best cards in the deck because not only is he a free sacrifice outlet, but you can tutor for any card, making it incredibly easy to assemble a combo or get your win con. Jared's Orders and Final Parting are also amazing at getting our win cons online. Either of these can get Gravecrawler into the graveyard, which can then be reanimated by just having Tormod on the battlefield. Final Parting is even better since you can then tutor for Phyrexian Altar if you don't already have it. Jared's Orders is still good since you can use it to tutor for something like Wayward Servant or a similar creature. Having access to green means that the deck won't have a hard time ramping as well as diversifying its mana sources. It's running Birds of Paradise, Avacyn's Pilgrim, and Elves of Deep Shadow, which are one-drop mana dorks that can help accelerate in the early game as well as becoming sacrifice fodder later on if necessary. These 3 are enough since I'm also running my favorite ramp trifecta, Farseek, Nature's Lure, and 3 Visits. The deck's running 6 basic lands as well as 6 lands with double typing and the Triome with Murmuring Bosque too, so they have enough things to ramp for. Besides, the deck's also diversified its mana with Mana Crypt, Soul Ring, Arcane Signet, Golgari Signet, Orzhov Signet, and Celestia Signet. Nothing special about these rocks besides providing some early game mana acceleration. It's good to diversify your mana base to be ready for anything. The final rock is Jeweled Lotus, which is more of a ritual for commanders. Both of our commanders benefit from it, so it's included just for that. While not entirely necessary to get the commander out as quickly as possible, the deck's not running much protection for Tormod, so being able to cast it quickly when we're almost done assembling our combo can go a long way. The rest of the deck is just the rest of the lands. The deck's running all 10 fetch lands, all 3 dual lands, all 3 shock lands, all 3 battle bond lands, Command Tower, Reflecting Pool, Endatha Triome, Murmuring Bosque, City of Brass, Mana Confluence, Ancient Tomb, and Temple of the False God, as well as 2 of each snow-covered basic land in case anyone's running anything that benefits us for it. As with all of my deck techs, it's not entirely necessary to run the dual lands if you don't already have them or aren't playing online. You can easily swap them out for pain lands, pathway lands, or even more basic lands, and the deck will still function just fine. This brew is just an idea of how to build around Tormod with Siddhar Kondo. Tormod is already strong, but giving him access to green and white makes him even stronger. Green gives access to effective ramp and the Gidrock monster, while white gives access to hate, protection, and Wayward Servant. What I love most about this deck is that you're not playing either combo or aggro. You can actually play both at the same time and then go heavily in either direction once you start getting pieces for either strategy. All cards work well on their own and most work for either strategy, so the deck isn't linear in the slightest. If you're interested in the decklist of the Spicy Brew of Mine, you can find a link to it down in the description. I would like to thank all my patrons for supporting me, and a quick shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage. I'd also like to thank anyone using my TCG Player affiliate link, that also helps out the channel. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of The Brewery on the Commander Tavern. I'm the Commander Kirby, and happy brewing!